When Stephen Shore was 14, three of his photographs were acquired by the Museum of Modern Art. At 17, he was a regular at Andy Warhol's factory. By age 23, he became the first living photographer to have a one-man show at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Today, he is one of our most pioneering and influential living photographers. His work has been included in numerous shows, and he's the director of photography of the photography program at Bard College. This amazing book takes readers on an unforgettable journey through Israel and the West Bank, as told through the photographs Stephen took on several trips between 1994 and 2011. He portrays the region's unique beauty, rich and tumultuous history, and uncertain future through his distinctive style of documentary photography, revealing facets of this complex land we might not otherwise experience. He's joined tonight by Sandra Phillips, Senior Curator of Photography at SFMOMA, where she heads one of the country's most active departments of photography, and where she has organized several major exhibitions over the past 25 years. So please join me to welcome Stephen Shore and Sandra Phillips.
Hi, Stephen.
Hi, Sandy.
Welcome to San Francisco. I thought we would begin our conversation by looking at some of the early work that everyone knows, and then kind of placing your interest in going to Israel and why you went there and why you went back several times.
Yes.
And then look at the pictures of Israel.
That sounds fair.
Okay. This is a picture made in Ashland, Wisconsin.
Yes.
And those of us old enough, like you and I, to know what this means, it means that it's the hometown of John Tarkovsky, who was for many, many years, first of all, a very dear friend of both of us, and for many years, the head of the department at the Museum of Modern Art, and the person who really, I would say, was your promoter in a way, was your champion.
Well, I saw him also as my teacher.
That,
I didn't go to art school. I dropped out of high school to hang out at the factory, frankly.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a choice of putting on a school blazer and tie every day and sit in classes I had no interest in, or hang out at Warhol Studio.
Your parents ever let you do that?
I think the choice was so clear that they realized it wasn't what they had envisioned for me, but
yeah.
There wasn't much they could do about it.
Good for them.
And I would have parties. I still was living at home, and I'd have parties at our house, and my father and mother befriended them.
Amazing.
There was one night that my mother got Nico aside and spent the entire evening in the kitchen giving her milk and matzos, and Nico telling her life story.
Amazing.
We could wind up spending our 45 minutes on that. But
maybe we should talk about John.
Yes, and so I didn't have any training.
Right.
And I would, whenever I had a new body of work, several times a year, I would go to visit John.
Mm-hmm.
And really, he was the person who was my teacher. And it didn't stop when I started showing at a gallery or even when I had a show at the Modern.
Yeah.
Those are just stops along the way, and you don't stop learning, and I would keep going back to him.
Yeah.
But when I went to Ashland and took this picture, I had known John at that point for 10 years,
uh-huh.
but didn't know he was from Ashland, and was just fascinated by the town.
Uh-huh.
And it was architecturally interesting.
I'm sure.
And there were buildings that were very Richardsonian in feel, which
mm-hmm.
connects to John's interest in Richardson's student, Sullivan.
Of course.
And I was photographing on the street, and a man came up to me, and I'm there with a view camera on a tripod. He says, "You're a photographer." I said, that's right. He said, "You're not from around here." I said, "No, I'm not." I said, where are you from? I said, New York. He said, I have a friend from high school who's a photographer in New York. I said, sure, it's quite possible. Well, he said, his name is John Tarkowski.
That's amazing. Maybe
we should go on?
Yeah, let's go on.
Or we could spend the whole time on this.
So we were talking about Eureka. This is the picture you chose for the cover of your...
Uncommon Places.
Yes. Can I ask why? I love this picture.
Part of the reason why... Well, yeah, I like the picture too, but it wasn't included in the first edition of Uncommon Places.
Uh-huh.
And I liked the idea of putting a picture on the cover that clearly marked the new edition as really a complete revision of it.
Right. So we should mention this is Eureka, California.
Yes.
A place where it's often very foggy. And it's also a town that has seen better days. It was a big shipping center in the 19th century. It was a place where you shipped logs from, or, It's a big forest there, too. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely seen better days. But you capture the mood of that town, which is small and very American. It's totally... But you also... There's a very characteristic light there, kind of pearly light. And it seems to me that light is your chief interest.
It is one of the things I think most about or pay attention to most when I take a picture.
Yeah.
It's all the camera sees is light. The camera doesn't see Sambo's signs, it sees light.
Yeah, yeah. So you were saying that you had taken this picture before and...
I took it actually the year before
from
the exact same spot, and the film was... About once a week, I would send the film back to a lab in New York to be processed. Mm. And they underdeveloped the whole batch. And so I liked the picture so much, I went back the next year. And
that's great.
And from memory, actually just stood in the exact same spot.
That's amazing. It's amazing. Do you want to move on?
Yes, let's do that.
So you said that... the light, particularly in the Southwest, interests you. You found it very rich.
Not only that, but it can communicate part of the psychological state of the picture.
Uh-huh.
And that I always associated a clarity of light with an internal sense of clarity.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I separate sharpness from clarity. Sharpness is a technical thing.
Mm-hmm.
Clarity is a psychological thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This kind of light seems to me to relate to the light of the more recent pictures, the ones from Israel. Is there...
Well, I like the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And light sounds too bland. I'm attracted to it.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I could go anywhere in the country, I would often just go to the Southwest to photograph.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the light, because of the land. When in the 80s, I was no longer doing pictures that were urban or suburban, but were natural landscapes. Where I wanted to go was West Texas.
Uh-huh. Go on.
Yeah. And when you mentioned the light, it made me think of when I was in Israel, which is a desert country.
Yeah.
It was perfect for me because it was these clear days all the time. And the assistant I used, I was part of a large project, 12 photographers. The project is called This Place. The show of the work will open in October in Prague, go to the Tel Aviv Museum, eventually come to the Brooklyn Museum and the Norton,
mm-hmm.
and I think there some other venues are in the works. Mm-hmm. But an extraordinary group of photographers were involved. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And one of them was Thomas Strut, and we shared an assistant. And one day the assistant told me, strange thing, when you take a picture, if there's a cloud over the sun, you'll wait for it to pass. Mm-hmm. When Thomas takes a picture, he'll wait hours for any cloud to pass in front of the sun. So it's simple. I'm from America, he's from Germany.
This is where there's always clouds.
Where there's always clouds. And we figured out how to photograph in bright sun with shadows, and
right.
He's figured out how to photograph
it's a terrific
an overcast.
Story. Terrific story. So maybe you should say something about the vernacular. You've made a your early work shows a very considered taste for vernacular subjects.
Yep. We're about to see and talk very briefly about some pictures I made in Italy in the early 90s in mm-hmm. In a town called Luzzara. And this is the village that Paul Strand had photographed exactly 40 years before mm-hmm. for a book called Un Paese. Mm-hmm. And when I was, before I was going, an Italian photo historian mm-hmm. Named Paolo Constantini
yes.
Sent me a copy of a letter Strand had written when he was working in Luzzara to some friend in America saying how hard it was to work there because there were no buildings of architectural interest. Mm-hmm. And I found that really fascinating mm-hmm. because it's not whether I would disagree or agree with that, mm-hmm. but what the words architectural interest meant to him.
Yeah.
There were no buildings that would be in a book of world architecture,
yeah.
or he would also be interested in buildings that express the some kind of deep humanity, perhaps.
Or the region, perhaps.
Well,
maybe not.
No, uh-huh. because, and then if you look through Un Paese, there are very few architectural pictures in it,
mm-hmm.
unlike his Hebrides book.
Mm-hmm.
For me, architectural interest means I'm interested in architecture as an external expression of cultural forces.
Mm-hmm.
I can't photograph a cultural force. I can only photograph things that are visible.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ways that cultural forces become visible is through architecture, through clothes, through mm-hmm. the way our cities and towns have developed mm-hmm. and the artifacts of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is where it becomes accessible to me as a photographer.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what, for me, architectural interest means. It has nothing to do with whether it is a classic piece of architecture.
Right, right, right.
And so that's why we have this.
Yes, which is really the architecture of our country, certainly at that time, certainly in the West.
Yeah.
Amazing picture. I love this picture because it's like the anti-Ansel Adams picture, really. Were you camping there?
I wasn't camping.
No. But it's such an inhabited picture, and it looks like it could be taken by almost anyone. I mean, obviously not, but it has the feel of it's accessible, I guess. Mm-hmm. It's got something common to all of us. We've all been there, we've all made snapshots mm-hmm. of that beach, but it's, of course, much more special. It's got this amazing light. It's got this amazing expansive space that's very different.
And also the configuration of the people. That's why that particular moment I photographed it. They were moving around, and at one point they formed this kind of triangle.
Yeah, it's great.
But now, this is Lutzara.
Lutzara.
And just a slight technical change allowed for an aesthetic change. Because I went to black and white film that was four times as fast, four times as sensitive to light as the color film I was using.
Wow.
So if I'm working at the edge of what my process can do, having two extra stops of exposure means I can take pictures that I couldn't take before.
Yeah.
And so I can deal with people in a way I couldn't deal with them with an 8x10 in color.
Indeed. So these were taken with an 8x10?
Yes.
Why did you use a big, heavy 8x10 camera?
I love the 8x10.
It's an intimate picture. It looks like it was almost a 35 millimeter picture. It has that kind of closeness, really. And the light is very beautiful, even though it's black and white light.
Yes, well, black and white light can be beautiful too. But it was a step in my exploring other cultures. Throughout the 70s, photographing entirely in North America.
Right.
In 1990, I did a trip to the Yucatan.
Right.
And this is when I was interested in traditional cultures. And how that can show itself in a picture, and to allow a picture to accrue some meaning from that, from that sense of tradition. And when the opportunity arose to photograph in Lutzara, I took it because I saw that this was where Yucatan was. Well, it also was a culture in transition.
Yes.
Because people in these very traditional houses that had not changed architecturally in 800 years have television sets now.
Right, right.
Here, this is modern Italy, but there's still this a remnant of an older culture that is very visible.
Right.
It's what attracted Strand, but this, if you said the other picture was the anti-Adams, this was in a way not necessarily this picture, but the project was in a way anti-Strand, because although he was photographing in 1952, there isn't a single picture in the book that couldn't have been taken 40 years earlier.
Right, right.
He didn't want to show modern culture.
Right.
There were no cars, and I wanted to look at it for all it was, which included television antennas and cars, but also the tradition.
Yeah.
At the same time, I was also interested in archaeology, and that's when I made the first trip to Israel. Was not to really explore Israel as a country, but to go on two archaeological digs, one in Ashkelon, which is on the Mediterranean coast, where this picture was made, and another dig in the north in Hatzor, which is just a little bit outside of Sfat.
And why were you interested in making archaeological pictures in black and white?
Well, black and white is, I can give you an easy answer. After I did the work in Yucatan, I realized I had been photographing in color exclusively for 20 years.
So why not try?
And I decided that for the next decade I'd work in black and white. It was as simple as that. It was as clear and stupid a decision as that. And why archaeology was for some of the same reasons I was interested in what I'm referring to as traditional cultures. A sense of the past coming through to the present. And in archaeology, it's almost physical as these things are kind of emerging from the ground.
So it's interesting to me that you would be interested in archaeological subjects and traditional cultures coming from making those pictures of chevron signs, and that's not traditional. How do you see our culture as a?
Well, I was interested in taking pictures that were about what contemporary experience was.
Yeah. And so when did you become interested in traditional cultures? How did the depiction of contemporary culture become more nuanced or more historical?
It somehow grew out of one body of work which I didn't show here, mm-hmm. which was the decade of the 80s, kind of got skipped over in our very brief little survey, where I was doing natural landscapes.
Oh, right, of course.
And it was kind of a reset. I mean, I understood that there was something almost anachronistic about doing in the 80s a natural landscape.
Yeah.
But it's what I was interested in pursuing.
Right, right.
And
in black and white, in fact.
No, in color. There are three series, four series.
Uh-huh. You were in Montana. Right.
In the Hudson Valley, which is not natural, it was landscape, but is peopled.
Mm-hmm.
And Texas and Scotland.
Right. Okay.
And it was somehow setting a reset button for me doing mm-hmm. that. And I wanted culture to creep in. I developed a particular visual technique that I've been experimenting with. And if I can be very specific, one of the questions fascinating me for a number of years had been, how can some pictures, even though I know that they're a flat illusion on a piece of paper, have an illusion, a very tangible illusion of three-dimensional space? And I wanted to figure out how that happened. And I spent a lot of time in the 70s thinking of formal devices. I mean, I can go back to a picture like this, which is a very classical structure, very, in fact, Claudian in structure. Of trying to set up the picture plane, have one point perspective, try to have formal means of communicating that sense of three-dimensional space. But then I thought, I was living in Montana and thought, I experienced this on the land. Can I take a picture on just open land that has that without the structural devices, without one point perspective?
And this speaks directly to some of these landscapes that you made in Israel.
Yes. And that's where I learned to do it.
Yeah. Ah, okay.
In Texas.
I got it.
but when I figured out how to do that, I then thought, okay, I don't have to do this just with landscape. Now can I bring human development into it? And I started with something that I felt somehow that it was right to start with something very traditional, and that's why I started with the Yucatan.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I don't know if that really answers the question. Does it?
It's okay. It's good. Okay.
And that brings us to Israel and the West Bank.
Yeah. So, you started with Ashkelon and
Hatzor.
And this interest in archaeology. But obviously there was this project that was getting formed, I guess, in the 90s or...
This happened in...
More recently.
Yeah, maybe 2008.
Uh-huh. So...
is when it first was discussed.
And this was by Frederick...
Yeah, a French photographer, Frederick Brenner, had the idea of raising the funds and getting about a dozen photographers to come to Israel and the West Bank and pretty much to do whatever we wanted. We all went on exploratory trips, as he put it, where we were...
You checked it out.
Where we were... he orchestrated it, in a way. We were bombarded with different impressions.
Uh-huh.
And so, for example, one day I spent half a day in Hebron with the leading Palestinian human rights activist, and the afternoon with someone from an Israeli think tank.
Uh-huh.
We have had a couple of meetings with Moshe Harbatal, who's a great philosopher,
mm-hmm.
the member of the Knesset, the Greek Patriarch of Jerusalem.
How amazing.
And he had, Frederick had good connections, so whenever, yeah. wherever you wanted to go, we could go. My assistant, who I referred to before, is Israeli, so he couldn't go into the inner cities, the inner Palestinian cities.
Mm-hmm.
So if I wanted to go, say, into Ramallah, he would make arrangements. I wanted to photograph inside the Dome of the Rock.
Uh-huh.
And he made it happen.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. So did you photograph with any other photographers there?
No, we were all working separately.
Yes.
And there wasn't really much overlap in uh-huh. terms of when we were there.
Mm-hmm.
A photographer named Nick Wablington was there for about a year straight.
Yeah.
And so he overlapped with most of us.
Yeah.
I made 6 trips over a 2-year period.
Yeah. So obviously you were very interested in this culture as well as the landscape. And,
yeah.
yeah.
It came at just the right time for me. I was fascinated by the place.
Uh-huh.
And there's also a technical side, which is there was a development in cameras where digital cameras the size of a large 35mm camera started to be made that produce results that are just extraordinary.
Yeah.
That on a, say, a 20 by 24 inch print would be almost indistinguishable from a view camera photograph.
That's amazing.
And so it's like having a handheld view camera.
Mm-hmm.
So I was attracted to the view camera because of the detail it could produce, and that it was continuous tone. It didn't have grain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this is what digital can do. And so this particular picture I could have taken with a view camera.
You could have.
I could have. Mm-hmm. I could have set up.
Mm-hmm.
But there are other pictures like this would have been very hard, and this.
Yeah.
That I could have and mm-hmm. did take pictures like that with a view camera.
Mm-hmm.
But this would not have been possible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And certainly not that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so it opened a whole avenue for me, just as I described mm-hmm. black and white, that it wasn't the fact it was black and white, but the fact I had 2 extra stops of shutter speed
right.
allowed me to take pictures of people that I couldn't have taken before with a view camera. This digital technology allowed me to take a picture like this that couldn't have been made before
mm-hmm.
with the quality. It could have been made with 35mm,
mm-hmm.
but it wouldn't have looked the same.
Mm-hmm. Do you still use it? Well, maybe you should talk about the view camera, the 8x10. Why you came to use it in the first place.
I came to use it because I had been working with 35mm and was...
And maybe we should think of a date, too.
1972.
Okay.
And wanted to make bigger prints.
Mm-hmm.
And found I couldn't make prints much bigger than this
mm-hmm.
with color negative film mm-hmm. because the film was so grainy.
Mm-hmm.
It would lose sharpness, it would lose saturation. So I wanted a bigger negative. And I got a handheld press camera,
mm-hmm.
like a crown graphic, the kind mm-hmm. of camera, if you've seen photographs of old press photographers like Ouija, these big cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And my intention was to take handheld pictures that were like the 35mm, but it didn't quite work out.
Mm-hmm.
The camera was a little too cumbersome to do what I was doing with 35,
yeah.
And at the same time, I started using it on a tripod and found I loved working on a tripod, and I loved working, looking at a ground glass, the glass on the back of the camera. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, if I'm doing this, I might as well go whole hog and get an 8x10.
Yeah.
And then entered this long period of this weird journey of going into an 8x10.
Yeah.
But the 8x10 on a tripod forces a very conscious decision-making process.
Mm-hmm.
You can't sort of frame the picture a particular way.
You can't be spontaneous, really.
You about the framing, you can't.
Yeah.
Well,
it's a meditative.
It actually feels spontaneous.
Uh-huh.
And hard to describe, but it feels spontaneous. I'm setting it up. I know the picture.
Yeah.
But there's something about choosing the moment that feels spontaneous.
Uh-huh.
Even if it's a picture of a building.
Uh-huh.
But through this very focused, very intentioned process,
mm-hmm.
I began to figure out what I wanted to photograph.
Mm-hmm.
It was expensive.
Yeah.
And so I would not take two pictures of anything. And if I'm photographing a street, I would decide where on the street I wanted to stand and not photograph it from six different places.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And over time, this wasn't my intention of going into the 8x10,
mm-hmm.
but it's what I look back and realize happened. I began to learn what, in fact, I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
Because these two shots could be equally valid,
mm-hmm.
but which one do I want?
Mm-hmm.
And as I learned that, I began to see more pictures around me.
Mm-hmm.
And then a certain friction started, where I would see many more pictures in a day than I could physically do with the 8x10.
Right.
And that's where verbal digression is actually leading back to digital,
uh-huh.
because with digital, I'm sacrificing a little bit of quality, but it's very slight.
Mm-hmm.
But I have the pleasure of solving more visual problems in a day.
Mm-hmm. I can take more pictures.
I could take 100 different pictures in a day.
Yeah.
And I still work the same way with the digital. I don't take multiple pictures of anything, mm-hmm. except if it's something in motion.
Right.
Like this picture.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, this picture was a single shot, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I've spent so many years only taking one picture,
mm-hmm.
that's still the way I work with digital.
Yeah.
So I can take 100 different pictures in a day with
that's
digital.
Amazing.
And if I were using 8x10, maybe 15.
Yeah.
And so that was one of my interests in it. It's just that for the sheer pleasure,
yeah.
I like taking pictures, and I could take more.
So maybe you should tell us about the kinds of places you were photographing.
I was based in Jerusalem,
mm-hmm.
and the country is so small that you can go anywhere. I mean, the furthest you could drive is Eilat, which is 3.5 hours, and be back for dinner.
Good grief.
And so, you know, I was going out every day,
mm-hmm.
from early morning,
mm-hmm.
till I photographed till it got dark, and then we'd drive back. That's the pleasure of having an assistant. Is
yes, right.
I'd go to sleep in the car, and he'd drive back, and we'd get back to Jerusalem at 8 o'clock at night, or 9 o'clock or something.
So you were based in Jerusalem.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and so I got to drive around a lot. I mean, talking about months of going out every day and
amazing.
Following a different route.
And how did you select where you wanted to go?
My assistant was wonderful and explored the country,
mm-hmm.
on his own and knew every inch of it.
Mm-hmm.
He was 27 years old, had been a student at the main art school there, Bezalel. And he had traveled to Europe almost every summer, but had a very profound sense of being in a small country that was surrounded by enemies. And was fascinated by the borders. So the very first time we went on a trip, we went up to the Golan Heights, and he went on some military road that we weren't supposed to be on, just so he could be at the border. He was fascinated by the limits he could go. And we did this all over the country, where he is like, he was compelled to see, you know, there's a sign, don't enter, and he doesn't care, and he'll drive across the desert and and go to the furthest extent of what he could cover.
Amazing.
In fact, I'd mentioned before that Israelis can't go into the zones of the inner Palestinian cities. And we went to Jericho, and he wanted to go in, and the guards who were Palestinian were perfectly fine to let him in, but they had to check with Israeli authorities, and they said, no way. You know, he'd made a case that he was taking around an American photographer.
Yeah, and, yeah.
They said, no way. And he was furious. You could just see him fuming because there again was this border he couldn't cross, but it was a border inside his own country. And we were driving across this kind of scrubland, and with the wonders of modern technology, I got on my iPhone and downloaded Gene Autry singing Don't Fence Me In.
How funny.
And put my phone on the dashboard of the car and played it for him.
So where's this picture made?
This is in Jerusalem, in an area that's largely populated by Americans.
So it's a very sort of international part of the city.
Yeah.
And
this
is
in Tel Aviv.
It looks like it could be made in any American city.
And this is in Ramallah. And this first group I'm showing you are all done with the digital camera.
So they seem, I would say, freer than your accustomed way of working.
Yeah. I mean, there was no way I could have taken this picture with a view camera.
Of course not. But that looks like a more formal picture. That looks more like...
But I can use the digital in a formal way. And so after this project, I've completely stopped using film. And the past 3 years or so, I've only used digital. And if I want a picture that looks like a formal 8x10 picture, I can do it. It's psychological, it's not technical. It's, you know, one of the problems with digital, I see as a teacher, is that often photographers pay less attention to what they're doing. There's less intentionality. And I think it has something to do with cost. I mean, if you're with 8x10, it costs, say, $45 every time I go click. With digital, it's free. And it makes you stop and think. And, but there's no, but digital doesn't force you to be sloppy. And you can be as careful.
Do you think that you have been able to use digital in this way because you have such a long history with 8x10?
Yes.
And so what about the future?
At Bard, the students don't use digital until their junior year. They would have had to do 2 years of film-based photography, including a semester with a view camera.
That's tough, but I think it's great.
I think it makes a difference.
I think it does too.
And then when they pick up digital, they have, a lot of them still get sloppy with it. But they have the mental reference of how they worked with greater intentionality that they can come back to if they want to. If they, and you have to make that choice. You have, it's conscious. This was, by the way, at the Sinai border. Again, one of my assistant Gil's trips where he wanted to take me right to the edge. That's actually an Egyptian guard. That's an Egyptian guard tower.
Wow.
But he faces into Sinai, not into Israel, because he wasn't there to stop Israelis from entering Sinai. Uh-huh. He was there to stop people passing through Egypt trying to get into Israel.
Uh-huh. Interesting.
Often Somalis.
Oh, interesting.
Who would make a run for it, and their job is to shoot them.
Oh, my God. So you went many times to Israel.
Yep.
Like
six times in 2 years. Mm-hmm.
So you were completely familiar with the whole complexity of this history, both now and in the past.
Well,
not completely familiar.
The word completely, I mean, I was more familiar with it than I was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm glad the conversation hasn't turned political, because there are people several million who've lived there their whole lives,
yeah,
who are a lot more familiar with it than I am. So I would say completely.
Yeah. But, so how...
This, by the way, is in Hebron,
uh-huh,
where the tension becomes quite visible. Mm-hmm. And I mean visible to a camera.
Yeah. Well, visible to somebody like you who's coming into it without knowing all that much about it. This probably, too. This is
Hebron, yes.
It looks like a... So how did you deal with the politics of...
Well, I was... I have a couple of answers to that. Mm-hmm. One is, I had in mind that I was part of a larger project.
Mm-hmm.
And we each are doing our own books, each of the 12 photographers.
Mm-hmm.
But there will also be a book for the project.
Mm-hmm.
And it's through that that different voices come out and different aspects of the country come out.
Mm-hmm.
So I never felt like I had to do something definitive, which I don't think I would be capable of doing something definitive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it's too complex, and I don't have the knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if anyone.
Yeah.
Maybe unless they were schizophrenic.
Yeah.
So I felt freed from that.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I thought back on in the late 60s, I was spending a lot of time in London and reading about, the news in the Herald Tribune.
Yeah.
And I remember it was at the time of the Kent State massacres.
Yeah.
And reading the news made it sound like everything was falling apart in America.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got back and found there was some crap that happened, but things didn't fall apart, because mm-hmm. the news doesn't report that the sun rose at 6:51 as predicted. And,
right. Life does go on.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I was interested in what else was in Israel and the West Bank, other than the conflict, which is what I mostly read about.
Mm-hmm.
So I was interested in the land. I was mm-hmm. interested in how the land was built.
Mm-hmm.
I was interested in daily life,
mm-hmm.
What the food looks like.
Mm-hmm.
But also, you know, this picture is taken in the north, in Safat, and this is an argument between two rabbis about head coverings for women.
Mm-hmm.
And one is saying wigs are acceptable, and the other is saying wigs are not acceptable. And there's this handbill. And that, anyway, this would be acceptable.
This is Ginger.
Yes.
It's a very personal picture, even though you see her only from the back.
That Ginger's my wife, who Sandy recognized in the book, but Sandy hasn't seen Ginger in
maybe 15 years.
Yeah. So I thought that was pretty amazing.
Well, it's a picture that's of somebody obviously you have feelings for. Mm-hmm. It's not just a picture.
If I can get personal, that's what I like about you, Sandy, is that a lot of modern photography is about the surface of the photograph.
Yeah.
And there aren't that many people in the curatorial world who really can make contact with the perception that some photographers still value in a picture. And that's one thing I've always admired about you.
Thank you.
And it may in some circles seem old-fashioned, but to my mind, it's
human and valuable, and well, it's a human, valuable picture. Maybe I should ask a question about your own heritage. I mean, it seems to me that you're not a particularly committed, interested, practicing religious Jewish man, or am I wrong? That's a complicated question.
It's a complicated question, mm-hmm. And I would say that this was not why I went to do this project.
Yeah.
And
well, that was obviously my question, yeah.
And that's how I was brought up, as you described.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that after spending 2 years there, I wouldn't say that's the case.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm
that
sure.
It had a real effect on me.
And it shows in the pictures, I would say. There's something much more introspective, I would say. Mm-hmm. In these pictures than the pictures that you're most known for, mm-hmm. which are more about the surface, mm-hmm. And about kind of a culture seen from a distance, mm-hmm. without a kind of emotional commitment to it. These are much more, they're much more Stephen Shore, the inside Stephen, mm-hmm. Shore, than the work that I'm most familiar with.
Yeah.
Does that make you happy, or is that part of your plan, or, or is this?
Well, it wasn't a plan, but those other pictures you were talking about were made 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And I would.
You're different.
I'm different. I would hope that I've evolved in some way in 40 years.
Yeah, yeah. Let's look at the.
So these are landscapes. Mm-hmm. Everything you'd seen in Israel and the West Bank up till now was made with the digital camera. These were made with an 8x10 on a tripod.
Mm-hmm. And you used this interchangeably with the digital.
And yeah,
from the first day.
I was using both.
And did you select landscapes to make pictures with your view camera? Did you decide that you were going to make landscapes with a view camera, I guess, is my question.
But I also, you'll see a few in here that are not landscapes, but I was doing architectural work with view cameras, cityscapes. Also, you'll see in the book, but not in the slideshow, portraits that I did, mm-hmm. with a view camera.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
It depended on the day. It depended on what I was photographing. Mm-hmm. I like working in the land with a view camera.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's very satisfying.
Yes.
For reasons I first explored in the late 80s in West Texas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
To be able to physically walk land with this big camera and decide, mm-hmm. this is where I'm going to put it down.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And to slow the process down. I'm actually mention something technical. Mm-hmm. Part of, there was one technical aspect of this idea of the illusion of three-dimensional space. Mm-hmm. And that has to do with focus. Mm-hmm. And if you were to read some textbooks on photography, like Ansel Adams, he talks about hyperfocal distance, which is maximizing the depth of field, which is the area in front and behind the plane of focus that is relatively sharp. And so you're, in his system, you're focusing a third of the way into the space of the picture. Mm-hmm. I came to realize that there is a gravitation of attention to the plane of focus in a picture, mm-hmm. regardless of depth of field. Mm-hmm. And that if I were to focus a third of the way in, it would draw attention to, in this picture, that first kind of horizontal band of dirt going across. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
But if I focus on the horizon, it's going to draw your attention to the horizon. Mm-hmm. But there's something else a view camera can do that the digital camera can't, mm-hmm. and that is, I can literally focus beyond the horizon.
My God.
It's just moving the lens back a little, you know, I'm focusing on the foreground, mm-hmm. and I'm moving back, and I'm moving it back. Now I'm right at the horizon, and I can just turn the knob a little bit, and the lens goes a little further back, and the actual plane of focus goes beyond the horizon.
My God.
Uh-huh. And that, I believe, affects how people see space in a picture, which couldn't be done mm-hmm. with the digital camera, because they don't focus past infinity.
Yeah, yeah.
Because no one would think, why would you make a camera that focused past infinity?
Right.
Because that doesn't make sense. What does it mean to focus past infinity? It's nonsensical. It's illogical.
Right.
So that's one of the reasons I use the view camera for the landscapes.
Yeah.
So I'll show you some more. As I said, I was interested not just in the land, but how it was built on.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I noticed
and
you
also... And this is a settlement in the West Bank, mm-hmm. In the distance. I'm sorry I interrupted you.
Mm-hmm. No, you treat cities as abstractly as land. They seem to be like rocks as well as mm-hmm. inhabitable spaces. Mm-hmm. You have a very interesting distanced view of the way people build, mm-hmm. the way land is and the way people build on it. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think these are very beautiful, but I think the pictures of cities are mm-hmm. really interesting. What happened here?
This is an old cemetery
uh-huh.
called Nabi Musa. Mm-hmm. I did actually find a cloudy day.
That's amazing.
And this is in Hebron, mm-hmm. at the boundary between the Jewish and Palestinian parts of the city.
Wasn't Joseph Kudelka making pictures of at the same time?
Yes, his work it was just published maybe 3 months ago by Aperture, a book called The Wall, mm-hmm. and all his work was focused on the security fence.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This, I think, is an amazing picture.
And this is one of the newer suburbs of Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm. And then you have another, yeah.
And this is a 6th century Greek monastery in the middle of the Judean desert.
Amazing.
And to get to it, I drove in a four-wheel drive for half a day with no roads, just across the desert.
Good God.
With these people who knew where it was and had a map and a compass.
Wow. And did you get to meet the monks in there?
Yeah. There are very few there. At one point, there were several thousand living there.
Yeah.
And now there are maybe 20.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's...
an amazing place.
Yeah, and it's in the middle of just nowhere. And it's spectacular.
How do they survive? Do they? They must have gardens and cattle and stuff like that.
I didn't see any cattle.
Mm-hmm. Or sheep.
There's, down in this ravine that it goes into is... a very small river.
Uh-huh.
I mean, river...
is a...
yes.
Exaggeration.
In Montana, it would be called a creek.
right.
Mm-hmm. And so there's a little water, mm-hmm. at least sometimes a year there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think they bring food in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This looks like Texas.
This is in the Negev, a meteor crater.
Yeah.
And this is looking across the Dead Sea into Jordan.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, you have to tell us something of the story of that house.
Well, this is in an Arab-Israeli village. So mm-hmm. this is not in the West Bank. This is an Arab village in Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just interested in the house because you could see the organic construction of it, how it just developed over the years,
mm-hmm.
that it wasn't architected,
mm-hmm.
that it just grew.
Mm-hmm.
Or was grown. Or maybe.
And what is this?
This is an area just on the edge of Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm. It's so interesting because you have pictures of the most profound desert and then pictures where everyone is just living on top of each other.
Mm-hmm.
The development is just so intense. But this is like a total wasteland. Looks absolutely
yeah.
biblical.
yeah.
Yeah, there's the...
This is Tel Aviv.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this is Hebron. This mm-hmm. is the Arab part of Hebron.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think this is take a look at this. And my sense is that the land feels different than the sky.
Mm-hmm.
That they're not just tonal continuations of the same material. And I think this picture is a good example of what I'm talking about when I'm talking about the three-dimensional space and focusing
yes.
beyond the horizon,
mm-hmm.
that for me, and I don't know if I'm just reading into it or if you see it too,
mm-hmm.
but there's a sense of the sky being beyond the land.
It's almost as if that mound is levitating somehow.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I would describe it. I love those clouds too, very sprightly. You did get some cloudy days.
Yes.
So what's going on here? This is looks like a very complicated geography.
This is at the edge of Hebron, where the city is beginning to turn into farmland.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So would you?
And here, this picture. On the right is a Bedouin camp,
mm-hmm.
and then on the hill, people kind of claim hilltops, and
mm-hmm.
sometimes the hilltops are settlements and sometimes they're Arab, and this
mm-hmm.
is in the West Bank.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this you could see a minaret there, and so you know that this would be an Arab development, an Arab village.
Up there on the.
On that first hill.
Mm-hmm.
And we're back.
That's it. Well, great. Thank you, Stephen. Is it time to actually ask questions from the audience? Is that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We have microphones on either side if you have a question.
Our first question over here on your guys' right.
Could we turn the lights up in here so we could see you?
Right over
That's
here.
Great. Hi, Mr. Shore. I hope you are enjoying your time in San Francisco. I was just wondering two clarification questions. I love the shot of the little girl with the men in the background. Would you be able to, number one, back up a little bit on the preparation on that? What you did, like if you went there before, a day before. And also, I was wondering, it sounds like you have been able to figure out how to shoot throughout the whole day in the lighting, and I was just wondering if you could just describe that a little bit, just a little bit on the technical side, because it's so hard to shoot in the middle of the day.
That's an interesting question, because I had first said early on that the light is almost the most important thing in a picture to me, but that said, I find I shoot all day long. And if I could only shoot part of the day, I mean, when I work, I get into a frame of mind where I just work, and I don't even particularly like stopping for lunch. I just want to work, and so I work from when the light first comes up to when it gets dark. And if something doesn't look right, if I'm facing one way, I find if you just turn around and look behind you, the light will be fine. I know that sounds stupid, but it's what happens. I don't find midday light any less interesting than late in the daylight. Now the picture of the girl you're talking about in Jerusalem, is that?
Yeah, where she was, you just caught her. She had like a little smirk on her face, and then you had the two black-robed guys in the back. It was a city scene. It was. She's a little out of focus. That one.
That one. Yeah. Well, there was nothing to set up. I was in a neighborhood of in Jerusalem called Mea Shearim. And it was spontaneous. I just saw her coming, and
she was.
I guess for clarification, I was just wondering, were you wandering around like the day before or something,
no.
And you saw that, okay, this no. is a good, okay, so it was just total.
No.
Okay.
One question here on your left.
Thank you. Mr. Shore, you mentioned the benefits of the digital camera, the fact that you can take more pictures without having to spend $45 per shot. But you did not talk about the fact that you can manipulate the picture once you have uploaded it into your computer. So when you're talking about the sky, the gray sky, the clouds, mm-hmm. you have never talked about the fact you can actually change the light a little bit, darken a part of it or lighten mm-hmm. a part of it. You wouldn't do that.
Well, I do that, but I do that to my other pictures also. All the prints I make are digital. So when I shoot 8x10 film, I have the film scanned and I make a digital print. But I don't do anything to the picture that a photographer wouldn't do in black and white. It's essentially darkening or lightening an area, changing the contrast. In color, it's changing, getting the tonality the way you want it. But beyond that, I don't do anything peculiar with digital. And again, since I print both my digital originals and my 8x10, I print them both digitally, one doesn't offer more chance for correction than the other.
Next question is also on your left.
Thank you. Mr. Shaw, when I travel, I often find that after a short time, I start to impress my psychological state or political sense of the place I'm traveling on the images that I select. So if I'm in Switzerland and I see a lot of loneliness, I start to find images that match that. If I'm in Israel like I was recently and I see conflict, I'm looking for images of conflict that express what I already think. So how do you keep your vision fresh so that you're really seeing what there is to be seeing and not impressing yourself on it? Or is that the whole point?
Well, I don't know if it's possible to not impress yourself on it. But what I would say is this, that in a couple of ways, it's inevitable that a photographer impresses themselves on a picture. And those are, in what you're describing, what to photograph, and then how to structure the picture formally. I showed you a picture before of the street corner in Los Angeles with a filling station and talked about the classical composition. When I was doing it, I was very aware that I was imposing a classical composition on a 20th century scene. But I think an attempt can be made, having said that, I think an attempt can be made to gear what one is imposing to a perception of what's there. I know that may not sound clear. What I mean is this. Let's say you were a scientist and try to describe some law of nature. You're imposing your mental framework on the world. Another scientist comes along 100 years later, but in doing that, you're also trying to express what you think is actually happening in the world. Then 100 years later, another scientist comes along and says, I can see that this is an imposition, that this doesn't really mesh with observation. And so I've come up with another law that supersedes it, that I think is closer to the way the world works. But again, that second scientist is also imposing on the world. But the attempt is being made to express something out there. And I think something similar can happen with photographers. Does that make sense?
Thank you. We have time for one more question.
Hi. I really admire the way in which you capture what you just called the contemporary experience, the sense of time. And since we've learned today your trick or your technical device to capture a sense of place by focusing beyond the horizon, I wonder if you have a sense of how you manage to capture the present and the time beyond the past or the future, so that is there in the photograph.
How you do that? I think it relates to what I was just describing, and that having done this for a long time, in the past several years, I've not been photographing in the United States much, and I've been interested in seeing, going to other cultures, and seeing if I can. The challenge for me is to see it freshly, to see it with a little bit of the detachment or the newness that may come from being a visitor, but without taking a picture that is a tourist picture, to try to get a sense of what's essential about this place. And so that's, in a way, part of the aesthetic challenge of going to a country I hadn't photographed in before.
Thank you.
Does that get to some things you asked?
Yeah, that's great. Thank you, Stephen. You've been very generous.
Thank you. Thank you.
I've actually mentioned something technical.
Mm-hmm.
Part of there was one technical aspect of this idea of the illusion of three-dimensional space,
mm-hmm.
And that has to do with focus.
Mm-hmm.
And if you were to read some textbooks on photography, like Ansel Adams, he talks about hyperfocal distance, which is maximizing the depth of field, which is the area in front and behind the plane of focus that is relatively sharp. And so you're, in his system, you're focusing a third of the way into the space of the picture.
Mm-hmm.
I came to realize that there is a gravitation of attention to the plane of focus in a picture,
mm-hmm.
regardless of depth of field.
Mm-hmm.
And that if I were to focus a third of the way in, it would draw attention to, in this picture, that first kind of horizontal band of dirt going across.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But if I focus on the horizon, it's going to draw your attention to the horizon.
Mm-hmm.
But there's something else a view camera can do that the digital camera can't, mm-hmm. and that is, I can literally focus beyond the horizon.
My God.
It's just moving the lens back a little. You know, I'm focusing on the foreground, mm-hmm. and I'm moving back, and I'm moving it back. And now I'm right at the horizon, and I can just turn the knob a little bit, and the lens goes a little further back. And the actual plane of focus goes beyond the horizon.
My God.
And that, I believe, affects how people see space in a picture, which couldn't be done mm-hmm. with the digital camera, because mm-hmm. they don't focus past infinity.
Yeah, yeah.
Because no one would think, why would you make a camera that focused past infinity?
Right, right, right.
Because that doesn't make sense. What does it mean to focus past infinity? It's nonsensical. It's illogical.
Right, right.
So that's one of the reasons I use the view camera for the landscapes.
Yeah.
So I'll show you some more. As I said, I was interested not just in the land, but how it was built on.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I noticed you
and
also...
And this is a settlement in the West Bank,
mm-hmm.
In the distance. I'm sorry I interrupted you.
Mm-hmm. No, you treat cities as abstractly as land. They seem to be like rocks as well as mm-hmm. inhabitable spaces.
Mm-hmm.
You have a very interesting distanced view of the way people build, the way land is and the way people build on it. I mean, I think these are very beautiful, but I think the pictures of cities are really interesting. What happened here?
This is an old cemetery called Nabi Musa. I didn't actually find a cloudy day.
That's amazing.
And this is in Hebron, at the boundary between the Jewish and Palestinian parts of the city.
Wasn't Joseph Kudelka making pictures of at the same time?
Yes, his work, it was just published maybe 3 months ago by Aperture, a book called The Wall, and all his work was focused on the security fence.
Yeah. This, I think, is an amazing picture.
And this is one of the newer suburbs of Jerusalem.
And then you have another,
And this is a 6th century Greek monastery in the middle of the Judean desert.
Amazing.
And to get to it, I drove in a four-wheel drive for half a day with no roads, just across the desert.
Good, good.
With these people who knew where it was and had a map and a compass.
Wow. And did you get to meet the monks in there?
Yeah. There were very few there. At one point, there were several thousand living there.
Yeah.
And now there are maybe 20.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's
an amazing place.
Yeah, and it's in the middle of just nowhere. And it's spectacular.
How do they survive? They must have gardens and cattle and stuff like that.
I didn't see any cattle.
Or sheep.
There's, down in this ravine that it goes into is a very small river. I mean, river
is a
yes.
exaggeration.
In Montana, it would be called a creek.
Right.
And so there's a little water. At least sometimes a year there. And I think they bring food in.
Yeah. This looks like Texas.
This is in the Negev, a meteor crater.
Yeah.
And this is looking across the Dead Sea into Jordan.
Oh, now you have to tell us something of the story of that house.
Well, this is in an Arab-Israeli village. So this is not in the West Bank. This is an Arab village in Israel. And I was just interested in the house because you could see the organic construction of it, how it just developed over the years, that it wasn't architected, it just grew, or was grown.
And what is this?
This is an area just on the edge of Jerusalem.
It's so interesting because you have pictures of the most profound desert and then pictures where everyone is just living on top of each other. The development is just so intense. But this is like a total wasteland. Looks absolutely biblical. Yeah, there's the...
This is Tel Aviv. And this is Hebron. This is the Arab part of Hebron. And I think this is take a look at this. And my sense is that the land feels different than the sky.
Mm-hmm.
That they're not just tonal continuations of the same material. And I think this picture is a good example of what I'm talking about when I'm talking about the three-dimensional space and focusing beyond the horizon.
Mm-hmm.
That for me, and I don't know if I'm just reading into it or if you see it too, mm-hmm. but there's a sense of the sky being beyond the land.
It's almost as if that mound is levitating somehow.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I would describe it. I love those clouds too. Very sprightly. You did get some cloudy days.
Yes.
So what's going on here? This is looks like a very complicated geography.
This is at the edge of Hebron, where the city is beginning to turn into farmland.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So would you?
And here, this picture on the right is a Bedouin camp,
mm-hmm.
and then on the hill. People kind of claim hilltops, and
mm-hmm.
sometimes the hilltops are settlements, and sometimes they're Arab. And this
mm-hmm.
is in the West Bank.
Mm-hmm.
And this, you can see a minaret there, and so you know that this would be an Arab development, an Arab village.
Up there on the.
On that first hill.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we're back.
That's it. Well, great. Thank you, Stephen. Is it time to actually ask questions from the audience? Is that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We have microphones on either side if you have a question.
Our first question over here on your guys' right.
Could we turn the lights up in here so we could see you?
Right over
That's
here.
Great.
Hi, Mr. Shore. I hope you are enjoying your time in San Francisco. I was just wondering, two clarification questions. I love the shot of the little girl with the men in the background. Would you be able to, number one, back up a little bit on the preparation on that? What you did, like if you went there before, a day before. And also, I was wondering, it sounds like you have been able to figure out how to shoot throughout the whole day in the lighting, and I was just wondering if you could. I'm wondering if you could just describe that a little bit, just a little bit on the technical side, because it's so hard to shoot in the middle of the day.
That's an interesting question, because I had first said early on that the light is almost the most important thing in a picture to me. And but that said, I find I shoot all day long. And if I could only shoot part of the day, I mean, when I work, I get into a frame of mind where I just work. And I don't even particularly like stopping for lunch. I just want to work. And so I work from when the light first comes up to when it gets dark. And if something doesn't look right, if I'm facing one way, I find if you just turn around and look behind.
So they seem, I would say, freer mm-hmm. than your accustomed way of working.
Yeah, I mean, there was no way I could have taken this picture with a view camera.
Of course not. But that looks like a more formal picture. That looks more like.
But I can use the digital in a formal way.
Mm-hmm.
And so after this project, I've completely stopped using film.
Uh-huh.
And the past 3 years or so, I've only used digital. And if I want a picture that looks like a formal 8x10 picture, I can do it. It's psychological, it's not technical. It's, you know, one of the problems with digital, I see as a teacher, is that often photographers pay less attention to what they're doing. There's less intentionality.
Yeah.
And I think it has something to do with cost. I mean, if you're with 8x10, it costs, say, $45 every time I go click.
Yeah.
With digital, it's free.
Yeah.
And it makes you stop and think.
Right.
And, but there's no, but digital doesn't force you to be sloppy.
Right.
And you can be as careful.
Yeah. Do you think that you have been able to use digital in this way because you have such a long history with 8x10?
Yes.
And so what about the future?
At Bard, students don't use digital until their junior year. They would have had to do 2 years of film-based photography, including a semester with a view camera.
Uh-huh. That's tough. But I think it's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it makes a difference.
I think it does too.
And then when they pick up digital, they have, a lot of them still get sloppy with it.
Yeah.
But they have the mental reference of how they worked with greater intentionality that they can come back to.
Right.
If they want to. If they, right. You have to make that choice. It's conscious. This was, by the way, at the Sinai border, again, one of my assistant Gil's trips where he wanted to take me right to the edge. And that's actually an Egyptian guard. That's an Egyptian guard tower.
Wow.
But he faces into Sinai, not into Israel, because he wasn't there to stop Israelis from entering Sinai. He was there to stop people passing through Egypt trying to get into Israel.
Interesting.
Often Somalis.
Oh, interesting.
Who would make a run for it, and their job is to shoot them.
Oh my God. So you went many times to Israel?
Yeah.
Like?
Six times in 2 years.
So you were completely familiar with the whole complexity of this history, both now and in the past.
Well,
not completely familiar.
The word completely, I mean, I was more familiar with it than I was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm glad the conversation hasn't turned political, because there are people several million who have lived there their whole lives,
yeah,
who are a lot more familiar with it than I am. So I would say completely.
This,
by the way, is in Hebron, where the tension becomes quite visible, and I mean visible to a camera.
Yeah. Well, visible to somebody like you who's coming into it without knowing all that much about it. This probably too. This is
in Hebron, yes.
It looks like a... So how did you deal with the politics of...
Well, I was... I have a couple of answers to that. Mm-hmm. One is, I had in mind that I was part of a larger project.
Mm-hmm.
And we each are doing our own books, each of the 12 photographers. Mm-hmm. But there will also be a book for the project. Mm-hmm. And it's through that different voices come out and different aspects of the country come out.
Mm-hmm.
So I never felt like I had to do something definitive, which I don't think I would be capable of doing something definitive.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think it's too complex, and I don't have the knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if anyone.
Yeah.
Maybe unless they were schizophrenic.
Yeah.
So I felt freed from that. Mm-hmm. Also, I thought back on in the late 60s, I was spending a lot of time in London and reading about, well, the news in the Herald Tribune. Yeah. And I remember it was at the time of the Kent State massacres.
Yeah.
And reading the news made it sound like everything was falling apart in America. Mm-hmm. And then I got back and found there was some crap that happened, but
yeah.
Things didn't fall apart because mm-hmm. the news doesn't report that the sun rose at 6:51 as predicted.
And, right. Life does go on.
Yeah. And so I was interested in what else was in Israel and the West Bank other than the conflict, which is what I mostly read about. Mm-hmm. So I was interested in the land. I was mm-hmm. interested in how the land was built. Mm-hmm. I was interested in daily life, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. what the food looks like. Mm-hmm. But also, you know, this picture is taken in the north, in Safat, and this is an argument between two rabbis about head coverings for women. Mm-hmm. And one is saying wigs are acceptable, and the other is saying wigs are not acceptable. And there's this handbill. And that, anyway, this would be acceptable.
This is Ginger.
Yes.
It's a very personal picture, even though you see her only from the back.
That Ginger is my wife, who Sandy recognized in the book, but Sandy hasn't seen Ginger in
maybe 15 years.
Yeah. So I thought that was pretty amazing.
Well, it's a picture that's of somebody obviously you have feelings for. Mm-hmm. It's not just a picture.
If I can get personal, that's what I like about you, Sandy, is that a lot of modern photography is about the surface of the photograph.
Yeah.
And there aren't that many people in the curatorial world who really can make contact with the perception that some photographers still value in a picture. And that's one thing I've always admired about you.
Thank you.
And it may, in some circles, seem old-fashioned, but to my mind, it's
human and
yes.
valuable, and well, it's a human, valuable picture. Maybe I should ask a question. About your own heritage. I mean, it seems to me that you're not a particularly committed, interested, practicing religious Jewish man, or am I wrong? That's a complicated question.
It's a complicated question, mm-hmm. and I would say that this was not why I went to do this project.
Yeah.
And
well, that was obviously my question, yeah.
And that's how I was brought up, as you described. Mm-hmm. And I found that after spending 2 years there, I wouldn't say that's the case.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm
that
sure.
It had a real effect on me.
And it shows in the pictures, I would say. There's something much more introspective, I would say. Mm-hmm. in these pictures than the pictures that you're most known for, mm-hmm. which are more about the surface, mm-hmm. And about kind of a culture seen from a distance mm-hmm. without a kind of emotional commitment to it. These are much more, they're much more Stephen Shore, the inside Stephen mm-hmm. Shore, than the work that I'm most familiar with.
Yeah.
Does that make you happy, or is that part of your plan, or is this?
It wasn't a plan, but those other pictures you were talking about were made 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And I would...
You're different.
I'm different. I would hope that I've evolved in some way in 40 years.
Yeah, yeah. Let's look at the...
These are landscapes. Mm-hmm. Everything you'd seen in Israel and the West Bank up till now was made with the digital camera. These were made with an 8x10 on a tripod.
Mm-hmm. And you used this interchangeably with the digital.
Yeah, and from the first day. I was using both.
And did you select landscapes to make pictures with your view camera? Did you decide that you were going to make landscapes with a view camera, I guess,
is
my question.
But I also, you'll see a few in here that are not landscapes, but I was doing architectural work with view cameras, cityscapes. Also, you'll see in the book, but not in the slideshow, portraits that I did with a view camera.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
It depended on the day. It depended on what I was photographing. Mm-hmm. I like working in the land with a view camera.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's very satisfying.
Yes.
For reasons I first explored in the late 80s in West Texas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
To be able to physically walk land with this big camera and decide this is where I'm going to put it down.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And to slow the process down.
When Stephen Shore was 14, three of his photographs were acquired by the Museum of Modern Art. At 17, he was a regular at Andy Warhol's factory. By age 23, he became the first living photographer to have a one-man show at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Today, he is one of our most pioneering and influential living photographers. His work has been included in numerous shows, and he's the director of photography of the photography program at Bard College. This amazing book takes readers on an unforgettable journey through Israel and the West Bank, as told through the photographs Stephen took on several trips between 1994 and 2011. He portrays the region's unique beauty, rich and tumultuous history, and uncertain future through his distinctive style of documentary photography, revealing facets of this complex land we might not otherwise experience. He's joined tonight by Sandra Phillips, Senior Curator of Photography at SFMOMA, where she heads one of the country's most active departments of photography, and where she has organized several major exhibitions over the past 25 years. So please join me to welcome Stephen Shore and Sandra Phillips.
Hi, Stephen.
Hi, Sandy.
Welcome to San Francisco. I thought we would begin our conversation by looking at some of the early work that everyone knows, and then kind of placing your interest in going to Israel and why you went there and why you went back several times.
Yes.
And then look at the pictures of Israel.
That sounds fair.
Okay. This is a picture made in Ashland, Wisconsin.
Yes.
And those of us old enough, like you and I, to know what this means, it means that it's the hometown of John Tarkovsky, who was for many, many years, first of all, a very dear friend of both of us, and for many years the head of the department at the Museum of Modern Art, and the person who really, I would say, was your promoter in a way, was your champion.
Well, I saw him also as my teacher.
That,
I didn't go to art school. I dropped out of high school to hang out at the factory, frankly.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a choice of putting on a school blazer and tie every day and sit in classes I had no interest in, or hang out at Warhol Studio.
Your parents ever let you do that?
I think the choice was so clear that they realized it wasn't what they had envisioned for me, but
yeah.
There wasn't much they could do about it.
Good for them.
And I would have parties. I still was living at home, and I'd have parties at our house, and my father and mother befriended them.
Amazing.
There was one night that my mother got Nico aside and spent the entire evening in the kitchen giving her milk and matzos and Nico telling her life story.
Amazing.
And, well, we could wind up spending yes. our 45 minutes on that. But
maybe we should talk about John.
Yes, and so I didn't have any training.
Right.
And I would, whenever I had a new body of work, several times a year, I would go to visit John.
Mm-hmm.
And really, he was the person who was my teacher. And it didn't stop when I started showing at a gallery or even when I had a show at the Modern.
Yeah.
Those are just stops along the way, and you don't stop learning, and I would keep going back to him.
Yeah.
But when I went to Ashland and took this picture, I had known John at that point for 10 years,
uh-huh.
but didn't know he was from Ashland, and was just fascinated by the town.
Uh-huh.
And it was architecturally interesting.
I'm sure.
And there were buildings that were very Richardsonian in feel, which
mm-hmm.
connects to John's interest in Richardson's student, Sullivan.
Of course.
And I was photographing on the street, and a man came up to me, and I'm there with a view camera on a tripod. He says, "You're a photographer." I said, that's right. He said, "You're not from around here." I said, "No, I'm not." He said, "Where are you from?" I said, "New York." He said, "I have a friend from high school who's a photographer in New York." And so, sure, it's quite possible. Well, he said, "His name is John Sharkowski."
That's amazing. Maybe
we should go on.
Yeah, let's
go
on.
We could spend the whole time on this.
So we were talking about Eureka. This is the picture you chose for the cover of your
Uncommon Places.
Yes. Can I ask why? I love this picture.
Part of the reason why, well, yeah, I like the picture too, but it wasn't included in the first edition of Uncommon Places.
Uh-huh.
And I liked the idea of putting a picture on the cover that clearly marked the new edition as really a complete revision mm-hmm. of it.
Right. So we should mention this is Eureka, California.
Yes.
A place where it's often very foggy. And it's also a town that has seen better days. It was a big shipping center. In the 19th century, it was a place where you shipped logs from, or mm-hmm. yeah, it's a big forest there too.
Mm-hmm.
But it's definitely seen better days. But it's you capture the mood of that town, which is small and very American. It's totally, but you also. There's a very characteristic light there, kind of pearly light. And it seems to me that light is your chief interest.
It is one of the things I think most about or pay attention to most when I take a picture.
Yeah.
It's all the camera sees is
yeah.
light. The camera doesn't see Sambo's signs, it sees light.
Yeah, yeah. So you were saying that you had taken this picture before and...
I took it actually the year before
yeah.
from the exact same spot. And the film was about once a week I would send the film back to a lab in New York to be processed.
Mm.
And they underdeveloped the whole batch. And so I liked the picture so much I went back the next year. And
that's great.
And from memory actually just stood in the exact same spot.
That's amazing. It's amazing. Do you want to move on?
Yes, let's do that.
So you said that the light, particularly in the Southwest, interests you. You found it very rich.
Not only that, but it can communicate part of the psychological state of the picture.
Uh-huh.
And that I always associated a clarity of light with an internal sense of clarity.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I separate sharpness from clarity. Sharpness is a technical thing.
Mm-hmm.
Clarity is a psychological thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This kind of light seems to me to relate to the light of the more recent pictures, the ones from Israel. Is there?
Well, I like the desert,
mm-hmm.
and like sounds too bland. I'm attracted to it,
mm-hmm.
and so when I could go anywhere in the country, I would often just go to the Southwest to photograph,
mm-hmm.
because of the light, because of the land. When in the 80s, I was no longer doing pictures that were urban or suburban,
yeah.
but were natural landscapes. Where I wanted to go was West Texas.
Uh-huh. Go on.
Yeah. And when you mentioned the light, it made me think of when I was in Israel, which is a desert country.
Yeah.
It was perfect for me because it was these clear days
right.
all the time. And the assistant I used, I was part of a large project. 12 photographers. The project is called This Place. The show of the work will open in October in Prague, go to the Tel Aviv Museum, eventually come to the Brooklyn Museum and the Norton,
mm-hmm.
and I think there are some other venues are in the works.
Mm-hmm.
But an extraordinary group of photographers were involved.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And one of them was Thomas Strut. And we shared an assistant. And one day the assistant told me, strange thing. When you take a picture, if there's a cloud over the sun, you'll wait for it to pass.
Mm-hmm.
When Thomas takes a picture, he'll wait hours for any cloud to pass in front of the sun. I said, well, it's simple. I'm from America. He's from Germany.
This is where there's always clouds.
Where there's always clouds. And we figured out how to photograph I figured out to photograph in bright sun with shadows, and
right.
he's figured out how to photograph an overcast.
It's a terrific story. Terrific story. So maybe you should say something about the vernacular. You've made a... your work, your early work, shows a very considered taste for vernacular subjects.
Yeah. We're about to see and talk very briefly about some pictures I made in Italy in the early 90s in mm-hmm. In a town called Luzzara. And this is the village that Paul Strand had photographed exactly 40 years before
mm-hmm.
for a book called Un Paese.
Mm-hmm.
And before I was going, an Italian photo historian mm-hmm. Named Paolo Constantini
yes.
Sent me a copy of a letter Strand had written when he was working in Luzzara to some friend in America saying how hard it was to work there because there were no buildings of architectural interest.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that really fascinating
mm-hmm.
because it's not whether I would disagree or agree with that,
mm-hmm.
but what the words architectural interest meant to him.
Yeah.
There were no buildings that would be in a book of world architecture,
yeah.
or he would also be interested in buildings that express the some kind of deep humanity, perhaps.
Or the region, perhaps.
Well,
maybe not.
No, uh-huh. because, and then if you look through Un Paese, there are very few architectural pictures in it,
mm-hmm.
unlike his Hebrides book.
Mm-hmm.
For me, architectural interest means I'm interested in architecture as an external expression of cultural forces.
Mm-hmm.
I can't photograph a cultural force. I can only photograph things that are visible.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ways that cultural forces become visible is through architecture, through clothes, through mm-hmm. the way our cities and towns have developed mm-hmm. and the artifacts of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is where it becomes accessible to me as a photographer.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what, for me, architectural interest means. It has nothing to do with whether it is a classic piece of architecture.
Right, right, right.
And so that's why we have this.
Yes, which is really the architecture of our country, certainly at that time, certainly in the West.
Yeah.
Amazing picture. I love this picture because it's like the anti-Ansel Adams picture, really. Were you camping there?
I wasn't camping.
No. But it's such an inhabited picture, and it looks like it could be taken by almost anyone. I mean, obviously not, but it has the feel of, it's accessible, I guess. Mm-hmm. It's got something common to all of us. We've all been there, we've all made snapshots mm-hmm. of that beach. But it's, of course, much more special. It's got this amazing light. It's got this amazing expansive space that's very different.
And also the configuration of the people. I mean, that's why that particular moment I photographed it. They were moving around, and at one point they formed this kind of triangle.
Yeah, it's great.
But now this is Lutzara.
Lutzara.
And just a slight technical change mm-hmm. allowed for an aesthetic change.
Mm-hmm.
Because I went to black and white film that was four times as fast, four times as sensitive to light as the color film I was using.
Wow.
So if I'm working at the edge of what my process can do,
mm-hmm.
having two extra stops of exposure means I can take pictures that I couldn't take before.
Yeah.
And so I can deal with people in a way I couldn't deal with them with an 8x10 in color.
Indeed. So these were taken with an 8x10?
Yes.
Why did you use a big, heavy 8x10 camera?
I love the 8x10.
It's an intimate picture. It looks like it was almost a 35 millimeter picture. It has that kind of closeness, really.
Mm-hmm.
And the light is very beautiful, even though it's black and white light.
Yes, well, black and white light can be beautiful too. But it was a step in my exploring other cultures.
Mm-hmm.
I, throughout the 70s, was photographing entirely in North America.
Right.
In 1990, I did a trip to the Yucatan.
Right.
And this is when I was interested in traditional cultures.
Mm-hmm.
And how that can show itself in a picture, and to allow a picture to accrue some meaning from that,
mm-hmm.
From that sense of tradition.
Mm-hmm.
And when the opportunity arose to photograph in Lutzara, I took it because I saw that this was where Yucatan was, well, it also was a culture in transition.
Yes.
Because people in these very traditional houses that had not changed architecturally in 800 years
right.
have television sets now.
Right, right.
Here, this is modern Italy.
Mm-hmm.
But there's still a remnant of an older culture that is very visible.
Right.
It's what attracted Strand, but this, if you said the other picture was the anti-Adams, this was in a way the not necessarily this picture, but the project
mm-hmm.
was in a way anti-Strand
yeah.
because although he was photographing in 1952, there isn't a single picture in the book that couldn't have been taken 40 years earlier.
Right, right.
He didn't want to show modern culture.
Right.
There were no cars, and I wanted to look at it for all it was, which included television antennas and
right.
cars, and but it's, also the tradition.
Yeah, yeah.
At the same time, I was also interested in archaeology, and that's when I made the first trip to Israel,
mm-hmm.
was not to really explore Israel as a country, but mm-hmm. to go on two archaeological digs, mm-hmm. one in Ashkelon, which is on the Mediterranean coast, where this picture was made,
mm-hmm.
and another dig in the north, in Hatzor, which is just a little bit outside of Sfat.
And why were you interested in making archaeological pictures in black and white?
Well, black and white is, I can give you an easy answer. After I did the work in Yucatan, I realized I had been photographing in color exclusively mm-hmm. for 20 years.
So why not try?
And right, and I decided that for the next decade I'd work in black and white.
Mm-hmm.
It was as simple as that. It was as clear and stupid a decision as that. And why archaeology was for some of the same reasons I was interested in what I'm referring to as traditional cultures.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
A sense of the past coming through to the present. And in archaeology, it's almost physical as these things are kind of emerging from the ground.
So it's interesting to me that you would be interested in archaeological subjects and traditional cultures coming from making those pictures of chevron signs, and that's not traditional. How do you see our culture as a?
Well, I was interested in taking pictures that were about what contemporary experience was.
Yeah. And so when did you become interested in traditional cultures? How did the depiction of contemporary culture become more nuanced or more historical?
It somehow grew out of one body of work which I didn't show here, mm-hmm. which was the decade of the 80s, kind of got skipped over
yeah.
in our very brief
yeah.
little survey, where I was doing natural landscapes.
Oh, right, of course.
And it was kind of a reset. I mean, I understood that there was something almost anachronistic about doing
yes.
in the 80s a natural landscape.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's what I was interested in pursuing.
Right, right.
And
in black and white, in fact.
No, in color. There are three series, four series.
Uh-huh. Oh, right. You were in Montana. Right.
In the Hudson Valley, which is right. not natural. It was landscape, but is peopled.
Mm-hmm.
And Texas and
right.
Scotland.
Right, 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 right. Okay.
And it was somehow setting a reset button for me doing mm-hmm. that. And I wanted culture to creep in. I developed a particular visual technique that I've been experimenting with. And if I can be very specific, one of the questions fascinating me for a number of years had been how can some pictures, even though I know that they're a flat illusion on a piece of paper, have an illusion, a very tangible illusion of three-dimensional space.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to figure out how that happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I spent a lot of time in the 70s thinking of formal devices. I mean, I can go back to a picture like this, which
right.
is a very classical structure.
Right.
Very, in fact, Claudian in structure. Of trying to set up the picture plane, have one point perspective,
mm-hmm.
try to have formal means of communicating that sense
mm-hmm.
of three-dimensional space. But then I thought I was living in Montana and thought, you know, I experienced this on the land. Mm-hmm. Can I take a picture on just open land that has that without the structural devices, without one-point perspective?
Right. And that this speaks directly to some of these landscapes that you made in Israel.
Yes. And that's where I learned to do it.
Yeah. Ah, okay.
In Texas.
I got it.
but when I figured out how to do that, I then thought, okay, I don't have to do this just with landscape. Now can I bring human development into it? And I started with something that I felt somehow that it was right to start with something very traditional. Mm-hmm. And that's why I started with the Yucatan.
Uh-huh. Okay.
I don't know if that really answers the question. Does it?
It's okay. It's good. Okay.
And so that brings us to Israel and the West Bank.
Yeah. So, okay, you started with Ashkelon and
Hatzor.
And this interest in archaeology. But obviously there was this project that was getting formed, I guess, in the 90s or...
This happened in...
More recently.
Yeah, maybe 2008.
Uh-huh. So...
is when it first was discussed.
And this was by Frederick...
Yeah, a French photographer, Frederick Brenner, had the idea of raising the funds and getting about a dozen photographers to come to Israel and the West Bank and pretty much to do whatever we wanted. Mm-hmm. We all went on exploratory trips, as he put it, where we were...
You checked it out.
Where we were... he orchestrated it in a way. We were bombarded with different impressions.
Uh-huh.
And so, for example, one day I spent half a day in Hebron with the leading Palestinian human rights activist and the afternoon with someone from an Israeli think tank. We have had a couple of meetings with Moshe Harbatal, who's a great philosopher, a member of the Knesset, the Greek Patriarch of Jerusalem.
How amazing.
And Frederick had good connections, so wherever you wanted to go, we could go. My assistant, who I referred to before, is Israeli, so he couldn't go into the inner cities, the inner Palestinian cities.
Mm-hmm.
So if I wanted to go, say, into Ramallah, he would make arrangements. I wanted to photograph inside the Dome of the Rock.
Uh-huh.
And he made it happen.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. So did you photograph with any other photographers there?
No, we were all working separately.
Nuts.
And there wasn't really much overlap in terms of when we were there.
Mm-hmm.
A photographer named Nick Woplington was there for about a year straight.
Yeah.
And so he overlapped with most of us.
Yeah.
I made 6 trips over a 2-year period.
Yeah. So obviously you were very interested in this culture as well as the landscape. And,
yeah. It came at just the right time for me. I was fascinated by the place.
Uh-huh.
And there's also a technical side, which is there was a development in cameras where digital cameras the size of a large 35 millimeter camera started to be made that produce results that are just extraordinary.
Yeah.
That on a, say, a 20 by 24 inch print would be almost indistinguishable from a view camera photograph.
It's amazing.
And so it's like having a handheld view camera.
Mm-hmm.
So I was attracted to the view camera because of the detail it could produce, and that it was continuous tone. It didn't have grain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this is what digital can do. And so this particular picture I could have taken with a view camera.
You could have.
I could have. Mm-hmm. I could have set up.
Mm-hmm.
But there are other pictures like this would have been very hard. and this.
Yeah.
That I could have and mm-hmm. did take pictures like that with a view camera. Mm-hmm. But this would not have been possible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And certainly not that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so it opened a whole avenue for me, just as I described mm-hmm. black and white, that it wasn't the fact it was black and white, but the fact I had two extra stops of shutter speed
right.
allowed me to take pictures of people that I couldn't have taken mm-hmm. before with a view camera. This digital technology allowed me to take a picture like this that couldn't have been made before
mm-hmm.
with the quality. It could have been made with 35 millimeter,
mm-hmm.
but it wouldn't have looked the same.
Mm-hmm. Do you still use it? Well, maybe you should talk about the view camera, the 8x10, why you came to use it in the first place.
I came to use it because I had been working with 35 millimeter and was...
And maybe we should think of a date, too.
1972.
Okay.
And wanted to make bigger prints.
Mm-hmm.
And found I couldn't make prints much bigger than this
mm-hmm.
with color negative film mm-hmm. because the film was so grainy.
Mm-hmm.
It would lose sharpness, it would lose saturation. So I wanted a bigger negative. And I got a handheld press camera,
mm-hmm.
like a crown graphic, the kind mm-hmm. of camera, if you've seen photographs of old press photographers like Ouija, these big cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And my intention was to take handheld pictures that were like the 35 millimeter, but it didn't quite work out.
Mm-hmm.
The camera was a little too cumbersome to do what I was doing with 35.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I started using it on a tripod and found I loved working on a tripod, and I loved looking at a ground glass, the glass on the back of the camera.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, if I'm doing this, I might as well go whole hog and get an 8x10.
Yeah.
And then entered this long period of this weird journey of going into an 8x10.
Yeah.
But the 8x10 on a tripod forces a very conscious decision-making process.
Mm-hmm.
You can't sort of frame the picture a particular way.
You can't be spontaneous, really.
You about the framing, you can't.
Yeah.
Well,
it's a meditative.
It actually feels spontaneous.
Uh-huh.
And
because
it's hard to describe, but it feels spontaneous. I'm
mm-hmm.
setting it up. I know the picture.
Yeah.
But there's something about choosing the moment that feels spontaneous.
Uh-huh.
Even if it's a picture of a building.
Uh-huh.
But through this very focused, very intentioned process,
mm-hmm.
I began to figure out what I wanted to photograph.
Mm-hmm.
It was expensive.
Yeah.
And so I would not take two pictures of anything. And if I'm photographing a street, I would decide where on the street I wanted to stand and not photograph it from six different places.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And over time, that this wasn't my intention of going into the 8x10,
mm-hmm.
but it's what I look back and realize happened. I began to learn what, in fact, I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
Because these two shots could be equally valid,
mm-hmm.
but which one do I want?
Mm-hmm.
And as I learned that, I began to see more pictures around me.
Mm-hmm.
And then a certain friction started where I would see many more pictures in a day than I could physically do with the 8x10.
Right.
And that's where This verbal digression is actually leading back to digital,
uh-huh.
because with digital, I'm sacrificing a little bit of quality, but it's very slight.
Mm-hmm.
But I have the pleasure of solving more visual problems in the day.
Mm-hmm. You can take more pictures.
I could take 100 different pictures in a day.
Yeah.
And I still work the same way with the digital. I don't take multiple pictures of anything, mm-hmm. except if it's something in motion.
Right.
Like this picture. Mm-hmm. But actually, this picture was a single shot, too. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I've spent so many years only taking one picture mm-hmm. that that's still the way I work with digital.
Yeah.
So I can take 100 different pictures in a day with
that's
digital.
Amazing.
And if I were using 8x10, maybe 15.
Yeah.
And so that was one of my interests in it. It's just that for the sheer pleasure, yeah. I like taking pictures. And I could take more.
So maybe you should tell us about the kinds of places you were photographing.
I was based in Jerusalem, mm-hmm. and the country is so small that you can go anywhere. I mean, the furthest you could drive is Eilat, which is 3.5 hours, and be back for dinner.
Good grief.
And so, you know, I was going out every day mm-hmm. from early morning mm-hmm. till I photographed till it got dark, and then we'd drive back. The pleasure of having an assistant is
yes, right.
I'd go to sleep in the car, and he'd drive back, and we'd get back to Jerusalem at 8 o'clock at night or 9 o'clock or something.
So you were based in Jerusalem.
Yeah, and so I got to drive around a lot. I mean, talking about months of going out every day and
amazing.
Following a different route.
And how did you select where you wanted to go?
My assistant was wonderful and explored the country mm-hmm. on his own and knew every inch of it. Mm-hmm. He was 27 years old, had been a student at the main art school there, Bezalel. Mm-hmm. And he had traveled to Europe almost every summer, but had a very profound sense of being in a small country mm-hmm. that was surrounded by enemies, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and was fascinated by the borders. So the very first time we went on a trip, we went up to the Golan Heights, and he went on some military road that we weren't supposed to be on, mm-hmm. just so he could be at the border. Mm-hmm. He was fascinated by the limits he mm-hmm. could go. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we did this all over the country, where he was compelled to see, you know, there's a sign, don't enter, and he doesn't care, and he'll drive across the desert and and go to the furthest extent of what he could cover.
Amazing.
In fact, I'd mentioned before that Israelis can't go into the zones of the inner Palestinian cities, and
right.
we went to Jericho, and he wanted to go in, and the guards who were Palestinian were perfectly fine to let him in, but they had to check with Israeli authorities, and they said, no way. You know, he'd made a case that he was taking around an American photographer.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
They said, no way. And he yeah. was furious. You could just see him fuming because there again was this border he
yeah.
couldn't cross, but it was a border inside his own country.
Yeah.
And we were driving across this kind of scrubland,
yeah.
and with the wonders of modern technology, I got on my iPhone and downloaded Gene Autry singing Don't Fence Me In
How funny.
And put my phone on the dashboard of the car and played it for him.
So where's this picture made?
This is in Jerusalem, mm-hmm. in an area that's largely populated by Americans.
Uh-huh. So it's a very sort of international part of the city.
Yeah.
And
this
is
in Tel Aviv.
Mm-hmm. It looks like it could be made in any American city.
Mm-hmm. And this is in Ramallah. Mm-hmm. And this first group I'm showing you are all done with the digital camera.
Mm-hmm.